Greetings, Mickey here. I wanted to talk a little bit about another build I'm currently planning, and that's gonna be a Magic Find character. First, about Magic Find in general, you need to play such a character a lot because you need to invest a lot into the character to start farming with IMF. You can usually, at the league start, go with some Magic Find character in mind. Start with it and build your magic find items over time. That's not a problem to do, but overall a full high tier well rolled magic find gear is expensive per slot. We're talking about 1-2x per item slot. So yeah, that's rather expensive and you need to farm a lot to make to make bank with it basically. I played another Magic Find character in Bestiary and it was Righteous Fire, Impulsors, Ascendant with Overkill, Leech and yeah, all the good stuff. I have a video on my channel about that build. It was fun for what it had to do. And yeah, I made a Headhunter in 3 days with the character and invested like 10x around that to start the character. So, yeah, and I even had some X left after after I stopped it. So, I didn't wanna play a Wind Ripper character, which is basically the go-to MF character. I wanna do something else, and I saw in PoE Ninja, like, two builds with Arakalis that have some kind of magic find gear, but not to the extent I want. So yeah, there are a few things I wanted to have in this build, and that was Greed's Embrace for the 50% item quantity of items found, and Divination Distillate. Those two items wanna be used in this build. So I wanted to use them, let's say it that way. And Reed's Embrace is basically a permanent Wind Ripper, because Wind Ripper characters don't use this chest. They want Queen of the Forest or something similar for the movement speed. So we have to play a character that uses a movement skill, like Leap Slam or Wailing Blades all the time. To deal with the movement speed penalty, and something like Goldworm has very low movement speed on its own, so you need something to move around quickly. So that was the first thing in my mind, and then Divination Distillate. It got buffed for my version of the build. It earlier had 4% max resistances, now it has 50% to all elemental resistances during flask effect. It grants a shit ton of quantity and rarity over time, so. And the elemental resistances helps a lot capping the resist, because my plan is to use the flask all the time while mapping. And yeah, the problem is it stops once we reach full mana and full life. If one of them is still degening, once we use the flask, it's fine. If I use it, it's instantly gone, or you cannot even use it with full mana and full life. And if you reach full life and mana, you don't have the quantity and rarity, so I have to deal with it. Let's see, where do I have the flask? Here it is. So I want to use it in combination with Soulcatcher flask, because we cannot gain mana during flask effect. So I basically pop the flask, use a skill, I lose mana, and I can use Divination Distillate. Okay, yeah, not in this character, because he uses EV. That's a little bit bad, but yeah, once I use a flask, it doesn't stop, and I cannot recover mana, basically, all the time. That's the plan. Okay, so I have to use a skill that doesn't have mana cost, or can bypass it via Blood Magic, for example, or Soul Taker. And a Soul Taker can use skills and uses mana with skills, but can use it without mana left. But Soul Taker is a rather weak weapon on its own. You need a lot of Abyss Jewels to compensate it, and but that's the version as well. But I thought, hey, I use Arakali Fang on this belt, why not use it on the other belt? Because I can basically, yeah, I don't need to use many skills at all to deal damage. Spiders do it anyways, and Spectres and Animated Guardian. So I'm basically playing some kind of summoner, like this Arakali build, but with another class, with Pathfinder in that case. Pathfinder grants us a lot of flask effect, and up to 54% flask effect. There are skill points over here. The Alchemist cluster grants flask effect, and let's change it here. No, not Duelist, I want the Ranger and Pathfinder. The small notes grant 5% flask effect each. I would take Master Alchemist for elemental ailment immunity and Master Surgeon for bleed immunity, because I only use one flask that can remove something, and I wanna remove curses. Basically, that's the plan. Maybe I remove Master Surgeon and use two small notes for extra 5% flask effect. Doesn't matter which one, both don't do much for us besides the flask effect. But that would just grant us 1% item quantity, and item quantity is what we really want. And yeah, it's probably not worth it, so I rather go with a bleed removal. It's safe. Some life recovery from flask, it's not bad, because I basically just use Writhing Jar to recover life, basically. That's it with life recovery on flask, so yeah. It grants some attack speed, which is nice for Wheeling Blades, because Arakali Fang, each spider we have grants us attack speed and damage with poison. It's 2% attack speed per spider. And yeah, with the class it's 60% attack speed, so we already got some attack speed there. And yeah, Spiritual Command grants us attack speed as well, and we get a bit of it on the skill tree. So we got around 100% attack speed. That's fine for Wheeling Blades. We should be able to move around quickly. Yeah, let's go with the skill tree first. I have it open here already. So I want Master Surgeon and Master Alchemist. Master Alchemist first. Normal Cruel Lab and Merciless Lab here. Nature Adrenaline, and then Master Surgeon. So this build doesn't have to run MF. I could just use normal gear and do all content with it probably. Because the DPS difference between an occultist version and a Pathfinder version is not really different. So I would just go for this route. Have all dexterity issues solved without gear, which is important. I don't get many stats on my gear, and I basically cover all my stats on the skill tree I need. That's a nice thing. And yeah. What would I remove? I don't need the minion life stuff, etc., because I don't go for bosses. And the starting notes here, let's remove this. So I'm at 114 of 123, that's already level 91, but I want the flask notes here. That's a bit higher again, but yeah, let's remove some 3-point jewels, and it's fine already. The DPS will be enough for everything into yellow maps without a problem. I could remove some smaller node here, I don't need mine over meta. This one can go away. So 110 of 123, I got something skilled here that has to go. So it's not much different from my occultist version, except I start with the ranger here and got some good notes with flash effect duration, flash charge gained, and reduce flash charge use, so flash sustain. And I want alchemist, of course. So I'm level 90 with this currently, and that's totally realistic. You can farm tier 3 maps, and at some point you reach level 92, something like that. And I plan to use. I'm not sure which maps I run, but I have something in mind. I will talk about it later. So, yeah, basically before that, duration nodes are not that much required to start with. I would just go for one first and maybe remove some smaller life nodes, some 5%, and you have a lower level, or some small minion damage nodes, like the 10% one. Not mandatory. So we can remove some points here and there and have a much lower level to start with, of course. We don't even need all the flask nodes in the beginning. So the Pathfinder basically grants us charges over time. We have a chance to not consume flash charges. We gain more charges, and yeah, I'm immune to ailments, so we can use many unique flasks, and we are immune to bleed, and yeah, more flask effect duration. That's nice. So our flask lasts long. We gain them quickly. We don't use much. So it's basically for permanent flask uptime. That's the reason for a Pathfinder, and the flask effect, of course. I would use a Conqueror's potency. It grants us 8% increased flask effect on top. That's a must-have jewel. Slap it somewhere here, and that's basically it for the skill tree, etc. Yeah, that looks like a decent skill tree at the moment. So not really much changed from the occultist version. Just some flask nodes on top. So this way, with all the flask effect, the divination distillate already grants 77 all elemental resistances. So keep in mind, it's up all the time, basically. So to cap resistance, we need minus 2% of all elemental resistances, basically. So, yeah. You don't need many resists. The magic find gear I will go over doesn't have many resistances, so that's not enough. But, yeah. Silver flask is another one. Not sure if I need it. I think about what's its name? What was the name? Flask, let's check it quickly. Some bismuth flask is nice as well. Grants additional elemental resistances. 35. Let's throw it in here. And it's another 53 resistances. So basically, both flasks would grant us 160 elemental resistances. So, yeah, you don't need any resistances basically on the gear besides what the Unix offer. I think some lightning rings, but yeah, some jewel can cover it. Resistances are not a problem. So instead of a silver flask, I can use a bismuth flask. Or bismuth flask. So yeah, that's my starting thought process. I wanted to use all the Unix items I could collect with increased item rarity, and with top rolls I can reach 128 item quantity and 141 item rarity. Without corruption on Piranha's Blazon, that can grant another 5% to 133. That's pretty much what is reasonable to get. But all the magic find items have a cost that's low, very low survivability. I can barely reach 4k life, so keep that in mind. It's not a hardcore character, and it's nothing you will reach level 100 with. Something you socket in a cast on death portal. you know, most stuff will die quickly, and for low or yellow tier maps, the survivability is enough for most cases, but it's nothing you will get past level 92 with, usually. But the damage will be still great, because Arakali's Fang is so OP. So first, Arakali's Fang, I talked about it in another video. You basically use Rising Jar with Desecrate and pop spiders up to 20. With my items here, Queen's Hunger and Devouring Diadem, it's a little bit clunky sometimes because corpses get destroyed by those two items, but I won't use them in the other build. Centauri's Answer. BOE, Centauri's Answer is basically just a shield with 8% item quantity, or up to 8%. And yeah, some block spells, nothing special, and punishment, temp chains and elemental weakness. If you block something, it's reflected or applied to enemies, ignoring a curse limit, it's okay, but we don't care about all that shit, we just want the 8% quantity. That's basically it. It's all about the quantity. I can... Let's go here. Then Greed's Embrace. I showed it in my inventory. It has some cold breath, minus lightning, minus fire, reduced movement speed, but high quantity and rarity. And it doesn't need to be a 6 link. I probably just need a 2 link. And that's it, because I'm not sure with the gems I will use in there. I know I will use my auras in there, but I'm not sure if I link them all together. We will see. I will go over it with the gem section. A rare minion life helmet, lightning breath and some life. So I didn't search something for that, but I wanna have socketed gems are supported by minion life, because that way I can use my animated guardian, basically. That's the plan. The Dima's Touch, magic fine clothes, I have some pair here, 10% quantity, I found it myself, don't know the cost currently. Shouldn't be that expensive, at least with low rolls. Then Goldrim Boots, up to 20% quantity, and yeah, I got one with 17 at the moment. It's enough to start with. Then a belt, Perandus Blazon, is it almost the cheapest version. I think I got a few here. Blazon. Nope, well, maybe I render them all. I don't know what the price currently is for it, but it shouldn't be that expensive. It's usually the Randus Blaze and Close Belt. One chaos item usually. Yeah. It's a one chaos or lower item. We want a max quantity roll that's at 8%, and you get it for one alc, basically. With a nice corruption, of course, it's even better, because the implicit is pretty shitty. There are a couple of ones, increased duration, AoE, quantity, and yeah. Let's go over PoE affix. There are some... What are the best ones for the build, except quantity, because quantity will be expensive. Yeah, skill effect duration is nice, increased life is nice, area of effect is nice, all rest is nice. Yeah, we don't use auras. Attack speed during flask effect is nice, rarity of items found is very nice, but of course quantity is the best one. You could buy a few eye level 84 ones for one chaos and try to val it, but yeah, well, that's probably way more expensive to grab it. So yeah, Biscus Leash is very nice as well, because it grants 5% quantity, a little bit lower, but rampage buff, which increases our movement speed and of the minions and increases damage, which is really cool. I don't know the price at the moment of Biscus Leash, probably a little bit more expensive than usual. Yeah, 30 chaos, it's okay-ish. That's not a big deal. So that's nice as well, because it comes with rarity on top over time, but I find Rampage a little bit annoying to keep up in Betrayal, because of the Betrayal encounters, the talking, and it's gone. Then you got Incursion, you look for the room, and Rampage is gone. You lose it a lot. Yeah. But it's nice to have. It's a nice magic fight item and grants some mobility for us and our minions. So that's very nice to have. Then we got the Pariah Ring. That's the most... most expensive ring at the moment for the build, except a very good rolled Ventus Gamble. But with a white socket, it grants 15% increased item quantity, and that's easy to craft with Warichi in Research, I think it was. It's a Warichi craft with a Betrayal encounter. You can attach a white socket to an item, and you get it. Comes with two levels of socketed gems. That's okay. Okay. And attack speed and cast speed. Attack speed is nice, it's always on it for mobility as well. But no life or no resistances. It's just an item quantity ring, the highest you can get on the ring in standard league. In temporal leagues, in standard you can get up to 20%, I think. So I want two of those, but I will start with some life ring or with item rarity basically. Nothing special. If I check something here quickly, maximum life and item rarity or rarity of item sound. Let's go for 40 and I don't know, 60 life, something like that. I don't care about resist because my next slot, I got one here for 1 chaos, another ring here for 2 chaos. With 47% increased rarity, so I would go for rarity instead, because a decent Winter's Gamble costs the same as a Pariah basically, and there's nothing that grants quantity except that, and that's another option. What was the fucking ring's name? Unique rings. Let's check it quickly. I always forget the unique names. I have every item in the game in my head, but always forget the name. Thief's Torment. That's another option. It comes with 16% quantity, but uses both slots. But it could be a nice starter item. Let's check the price. Thief's Torment. Prismatic ring. 1 chaos. Yeah, okay. That's some... that one. The corrupted one. But 7 chaos. I will probably start with Thief's Torment. Honestly. It grants all resist and quantity. And yeah, a good quantity rolled item is of course a little bit more expensive, but 10 chaos. If we compare it with Pariah, I would start with this one, basically. Yeah, those are bricked. You want a socket in there. And let's go for a white socket. If you want to buy a white socket one, it's 1x, basically. Yeah, it starts with 1x. That's a troll thing. So 2x for the rings, basically. And up to this point, Thief's Torment for 10 chaos, basically. Whoop. All the windows here. Two Pariahs, and yeah, for the amulet, either a rare amulet, shaper items, scan roll item quantity, then we can get corrupted items, talismans with item quantity, that's possible. Biscus Collar is another great magic find item, comes with rarity and item quantity of white mobs and item rarity of blue mobs. It got nerfed a lot, and I would rather use a rare amulet over it because betrayal mobs have a shit ton of good drops usually. And then we got the ascetic. It's not bad as well. The ascetic, it grants us item quantity with a magic item equipped, so we can basically use our helmet slot, just a blue helmet with a minion support gem basically and something else, something to slap with an alteration or augmentation or craft on it, and just use a blue helmet and we get the quantity. I don't care about the rarity basically. I want divination card drops. That's the most important thing for me, and currency drops of course. So yeah, I'm not sure for what I go. It's the early game, but over the long run I will most likely go for a rare ring. We can check some rares here. Item quantity. Quantity of item found. Let's go for 8%. 10% is the maximum. And the amulet slot. Amulet and rare. No white socket, of course. Yeah, we start with one exalted basically, with 8% quantity. You can try craft something yourself, but it's a rare roll basically. Or grab some talisman with it. So before that, ascetic is one chaos item basically, and Biscos currently 20 chaos to 30 chaos. Can go higher with top rolls of course, but yeah, that are basically the options. Then the anime guardian, I will use a kingmaker. Oh, nobody knows that weapon. I go over PoE wiki a lot. Nearby allies have 30% increased item rarity. I don't care much about rarity, but that's nice to have. Nearby allies, that's me, my minions, etc. And nearby allies have culling strikes, that's basically 11% more damage. So culling strike, that's a nice DPS weapon and item rarity weapon. So my animated guardian will use that. And on top, nothing special. Victorious Flight grants movement speed and a Leer cast or a Delph crafted helmet with nearby enemies take increased physical damage taken. Take increased physical damage to boost our DPS with the spiders, because they're mainly physical damage based. Then he can grab some Curse on Hit Cloth with vulnerability, corruption. Those should be pretty cheap as well, because we can use any glove, nothing special. Implicit, cast enemies with vulnerability on hit. Yeah, one chaos, two chaos. It really doesn't matter which pair of gloves he uses, because yeah, I intend to run lower tier content, no high tier maps, and he won't die. That shouldn't be the case. So I can slap something on it. Just vulnerability on hit for extra single target damage. I don't care that much about cursing all the mobs. So that's about the gear. For the gems. So melee splash, melee fizz and minion damage for the weapon, which is the support for my spiders basically. In my offhand I use Desecrate and Spell Cascade, something to self-cast to start my spiders. basically. And yeah, if I am in the situation where my spiders run out, etc., and I have no mana, I wait a second until my flask runs out, run out, and cast Desecrate because I regenerate mana again and can use it. I have some mana left, 7% or something like that, not too much. And the third one can be used for gem leveling and yeah, to sell the gems later. Some yeah, Enlighten, Enhance, Empower or Meta gems to level 21, 20 them, something like that. There's nothing required here on top of that. The body armor, I will use Hatred, Enlighten, Generosity and Vile Haste. And I'm not sure if I link Haste to Generosity. I will see how well my Wheeling Blade speed will work out. And then I can use Cast on Death Portal maybe in that setup. That's another option as well. Or I use the other two slots again for gem leveling. Gem leveling is currency on top. So yeah, maybe Hatred, Enlighten, Generosity and Vile Haste on its own. Or all linked. I will see. Mana won't be a problem. I need something unreserved for the flask, etc. But basically not much. In the helmet, I will use Ray Spectre, Minion Resistances, Blood Magic and Animated Guardian in a helmet with minion life. So, for the Spectres, I use those apes that are stuck again. They are always stuck here. Yeah, they are stuck again. Let's get them out. Yeah. Those use some Enduring Cry like thing and grants frenzy charges to everyone that is allied with them. So yeah, the spiders grant frenzy charges or gain frenzy charges all the time. And myself as well for more attack speed as well. Minion res for survivability, blood magic, so they cast it all the time or they won't do it without blood magic. And yeah, minion life of course, animated guardian like I said with the gear. Then I use gloves with custom damage taken, desecrate, flash offering and orb of storms. Orb of storms for elemental equilibrium of course. Flash offering and desecrate in that order, that's important, first desecrate in the link order. So in this one I would cast when I use cast when damage taken, then desecrate and then I would use flash offering. The order is important. In that case I could use desecrate here and flash offering here. Because they are casted yeah, all basically the same, but there's some order attached as well and yeah. If the order is wrong, you basically flash offering first and then cast the corpse, so yeah. Nothing really happens. Orb of Storms doesn't matter in which slot it is. And then Wheeling Blades, faster attacks, 45 blood magic because I won't have mana to spend. Yeah, in a ring, in a pariah, I would use a portal and another ring slot to level gems. Or if I don't link Vile Haste, I would use Vile Haste in here because of the plus 2 levels. And yeah, that's basically it about the gems. Druidress Elixir, we take damage, we gain some charges, power, endurance and frenzy charges if we use it, and we take damage. This one will proc cast when damage taken every time we use a flask. That's the main reason why it's in here. So I can just press a flask and pop my flash offering, debuff enemies with Orb of Storms, etc. Yeah. That's nice to have. We could use, instead of gem leveling, another cast when damage taken Immortal Call, for example, in here. Or similar. Rising Jar for the warmth to spawn our spiders with Desecrate. Then a Silver or Bismuth Flask, if resists are needed, Bismuth Flask. With Curse Removal, it's the only important immunity we don't have. Soul Catcher and Divination Distillate. Soul Catcher mainly so we don't regenerate mana or recover mana at all. We cannot gain any mana, but it reduces the soul cost doing during the effect, and the soul gain prevention duration is reduced. That's a pretty bad roll in this one here. Up to 40% reduced soul gain prevention duration, and that helps a lot. Especially it scales with the flask effect on top. So yeah, with a top rolled one, 25-40, it's 38.5% reduced soul cost and 61.6 reduced soul gain prevention. It helps a lot with the uptime of Wall Haste. That's a nice side effect. On top we have phasing and some dodge. That's cool as well. Nothing special. So for Jewels, Conqueror's Potency, like I already said, for the flask effect. And yeah, Jewels, we want a lot of minion movement speed, so they clear fast, so mainly I would go this route. Resist are in here as well. And yeah, life, resist, and there's some other minion stuff I didn't write down that much here. And for normal Jewels, we basically have minion damage, life, resist, and item rarity. That's possible to roll as well. Not that important, I would say. And yeah, that's 40, not 41. I don't think buff effect will affect it at full stacks for 1% extra. I think it's rolled per stage. So yeah, that's basically it. The good thing is we don't need a 6 link and just 3 off callers for Haste, Hatred and Enlighten. That's easy to roll with a crafting badge. Throw it in here. Link it later. First you want 6 sockets, of course, to level gems. And go for at least 1 green. I did it in 3 tries, I think. And I even got 4 off colors. It's not that hard, it only has 106 strengths. If you don't know it, the chance to roll from colors is depending on the attribute requirements. High strength means it's harder to roll off colors and it's more likely to roll red. But we only need 2 green for haste and hatred and 1 blue for enlighten. And yeah, link it to a 4 link to fit the colors basically. Yeah, that's basically about it. I got my flask set up, nice quantity resist, high res of course. I cover most of the resists here. I prevent my mana from regenerating, so this flask runs all the time. One flask for chorus removal basically, could be anything. Silver flask is for attack speed basically. Bismuth, yeah, both together basically cover all the resistances. Rising jar for the worms, that's important. Druid dress elixir, so I don't have to do, well, it's for quality of life, so I don't have to recast flash offering and orb of storms all the time. Just pop the flask and boom, fed it. It's done. So I don't want to press many buttons, so basically I just wheeling blade around with the character, press my flask and spiders do the rest. Except if I need, I use desecrate and my warm flask. It's just important to use soul catcher first, so for me it would be in slot 1. And then the divination distillate. Or the soul catcher, you need to spend mana then. And then use the distillate. Once the flasks are rolling and you have it, you reuse them once before the duration ends. That's not a problem. But you need to spend a tiny bit of mana first. That's usually the desecrate. Once it's 28 mana costs and something left, and that's a high level gem. It doesn't need to be a high level gem. Where is it here? Yeah, it's level 20. A level 1/1. That's basically the same and has lower, less mana. But you need to use the soul catcher first, then desecrate to spend the mana, and then the divination distillate to start the ball rolling basically. And the other flasks, when they are needed. Yeah, life recovery is mainly via Risinger. It's an instant flask, and we have some extra life on the skill tree via flasks like this profane chemistry, 50% increased recovery. The ascendancy gives grants us 30%. So it's from that alone almost doubles the health chain, and yeah, flask effect affects it as well. So Risinger, I want almost 600 life. It's with all the flask effect and life effect, something like 1.3k life instant flask. That's nice to have. The mana recovery won't do anything as long as Soul Catcher is up. Okay, I think I covered everything important. It will take a few days to build the character and to level it, because yeah, I will probably go for SIS for leveling with my videos are so long. I have so much things in my mind. Raging I got one dropped. Leveling gear? Yeah. Mark of the Red Covenant. You only have 5 SAS, basically. 5. What's the maximum SAS? I think it's still 20. It's still 20, I think. Dup, dup, dum. Oh god, it nerfed. I didn't use SIS a long time. Oh, fuck. Double click. Yeah, 20. It's, you have basically 5 SIS, but they are stronger and refresh more often. They always ignite, doesn't matter, but they have a lot of increased damage. 143%, and you don't have to recast them as often. So that's a nice leveling helm for SIS. And I will use it until I can use Arakali Fang, which is, I think, level 68. Ah, 53 only. Oh, that's even better. So with level 53, I can basically use Arakali Fang already. So even before the crew lab. Yeah, that's nice. But that's level 60, Risinger. So before level 60 I wouldn't use it. That's nice for leveling. And yeah, my strategy for mapping for the Atlas is basically I wanna farm Jungle Valley map. I shaped it to tier 16 because I like the map, but I will remove it, and it's just a tier 5 map basically. I made a few tests. Jungle Belly here. I got only one left, but that should be enough to start. So it's a tier 5 map, and to sustain it, I can either buy all the Jungle Bellies, but I don't really want. Instead, I will remove all those tier 6 maps on the Atlas, except Jungle Belly, except Crescent. I will shape this map to tier 11. This way, no tier 6 map can drop, except the adjacent one, but if it's shaped, it cannot drop. So this would always drop, even if I remove it from the Atlas, but if I shape it, it's a tier 11 map and it cannot drop anymore. I'm not sure if I have to remove tier 6 maps. It's probably easy enough to sustain the tier 5 maps without removing tier 6 maps, because that would remove a possibility of a sextant as well. And yeah, of course I remove all the tier 5 maps, but shouldn't be a big problem because I have a lot of sextants left to reshape my Atlas. So, yeah, why Jungle Valley? Why should I farm in Jungle Valley? There are a few reasons. First, a divination card, the web. It grants us a weapon of crafting, or if you sell it. It goes for one chaos per card, basically. Or even two chaos per card. Or four chaos per card. Yeah. If you sell them in bulk, like 100, you can probably take 3 chaos for it. Or 2.5, something like that. So it's at least 1.5 chaos, basically. Also, only sell 1 or 2 web cards. If someone wants to buy web cards, he wants to buy many. And if you offer 100 of them, yeah, you can take a higher price for it. Like 2 or 3 chaos, at least. So, yeah, every card that drops of them, in my last map, I got two drops. It's basically 2 chaos per card, that's nice. But PoE Wiki tells me it doesn't drop. It only dropped in Jungle Valley in Atlas of Worlds, but not in Betrayal. Ah, that's not true. That's wrong on this one. I earlier made a run with this character to find one of the web cards because I remembered that shit dropped in that map. That's wrong. It's wrong. So yeah, I run around a little bit here and. A web card dropped in the Jungle Valley map, of course. So, PoE Wiki is wrong on this one. The card definitely drops there, and Jungle Valley has a few benefits besides that. It's a very small map, so you have a lot of betrayal encounters. Betrayal encounters are profitable. You get a lot of currency this way. There are a lot of videos talking about how to make currency of it, but yeah, it's a quick map to run. It's very linear. It's okay to use with healing blades. Not many. There are no rivers or something like that can stop you, and something like Sleep Slam would be better. So it's nice to move around. It's small, and it's very quick for many betrayal accounts, and you find. It's open, that's nice for something like breaches. Yeah, you find master missions quickly. So, it's a lot of benefits. Then the Flora's gift card drops are 5 linked staff, and it's always 6 sockets. So, that's a lot of Juvelaw ops from this card alone. Encroaching Darkness, of course, that's okay. The Wind can drop a Wind Ripper card. Wind Ripper, I don't think it's that expensive this league. And Wind Ripper, the card is very rare. Most people don't even know that this card exists. I think I got one dropped once. So yeah, all those are corrupted here. I don't know, maybe 20 chaos. The wine card is not that great. Yeah. So basically 2 white seconds, sextants here, or 3 with this included. So I could use all my sextants as well. Yeah, but I won't use sextants early on, I think. Maybe to toy around a little bit. So mainly for the web card, I choose this one, but it has a lot of side benefits of quick to navigate and other cool cards for Jubilee Orbs, for currency, which always sells or can be used yourself. And yeah, mainly the web card, because I wanted to craft a little bit myself. And yeah, it always has multi-mod on it. Multi-modding on a blue weapon, you use a regal orb, have a yellow weapon and can attach 4 mods on it. And that's pretty cool what you can do with it. I have some here. I didn't hit regals with these, but I bought them for 1 chaos because they are shitty bases, but good bases sell for a lot of currency, 50 chaos, 1x, if you got a good base with a multicraft. And I could basically use a null orb for 50-50 chance to remove the lightning damage. But I could craft some very good offhand for a summoner, for example. You have 2-3 prefixes and suffixes all the time, and if you can annul the prefix, you even have 3. So we got some minion stuff here. We can get attack speed and cast speed for minions and increased damage. I'm not sure if there's a tier 4 roll. I haven't unlocked, I have to check it. But yeah, you can have 2 minion rolls here. Then we can have a trigger. Trigger socketed spells, for example. So we have the suffix is basically full for a minion weapon. And yeah, you could add two more prefixes. And there's a lot to grab on this one. Plus to support it, yeah, that's a little bit expensive to sell. But some multiplier thing for some builds can be nice. Or general stuff for summoners, that's not really much. You can craft some mana, for example, nothing special. Or you can, yeah, craft some melee weapons, something like that. Or just sell the bases or sell the cards. I will probably turn in a lot of cards and see what I can get and toy around with the crafts. Maybe sell them then. Stick some 20 chaos into a weapon and sell it maybe for an X, something like that. that's the plan basically. And if I'm pretty unlucky or I don't want to, I sell the web with magic find equipment without the scarab with divination cards. I should be dropping at least 2 or 3 per map. At least, and yeah, that's 5-6 chaos, something like that, depending on the market value from that card alone per map. That's nice, and of course, all the other benefits with increased items dropping, betrayal encounters are very quick, etc. So yeah, that's now I'm done. So that's my plan. that's what I wanna do. Jungle Valley farming. A lot of Jungle Valley farming. I wanted to make another build earlier this morning. A Hiltless build. A Hiltless Juggernaut with Perma Immortal Call basically. Well, almost permanent. Charge Dash, etc. Got a few versions. Everything planned, and then I checked. Yeah, a 6 link. Hiltless cost 2x, I don't have 2x, and I could start on a budget, but yeah, you play the character maybe a week and then reroll to something else again, and yeah, let's farm some currency first to refill it. Basically, I have 55 chaos left to fill out the other item slots, and yeah, then I will have to start farming, basically. Okay, that was a long one, like always. I cannot keep it short. But, yeah, I think it's nice if you're listening while you're driving or something. There's not much to watch on the screen, basically. I hoped you learned a few things with my planning of a build, etc. Okay, that's about it. Have a nice day. Bye bye.